Every time a trans woman has an MMA fight, everyone gets angry. LGBT activists are on one side of the discussion, and anyone that knows anything about combat sports are usually on the other side.
So fairness is the inclusion of trans women.
It's is as much cheating as taking steroids when the other person doesn't, maybe even more so.
A lot of people instinctively feel like trans women shouldn't be allowed to fight cis women, but they can't explain why. The conversation usually focuses around an athlete's current testosterone levels. While that might seem intuitive, it's extremely misleading. An athlete's current testosterone levels do not matter in this discussion. We all know that testosterone plays important roles in muscle hypertrophy, bone mass, and general differences between men and women. However, it's more about what your testosterone level was throughout your life than what it is right now. For example, if I injected myself with super physiological amounts of testosterone, I would probably be able to pack on a lot more muscle. When a muscle cell grows larger, it needs more nuclei to function properly. So some of the cell's energy goes towards creating more nuclei. However, once these nuclei are created, they never go away. You might have heard that it's easier for a former athlete to get back in shape than it is for somebody to get in shape for the first time, and a buildup of myonuclei is one of the reasons why. A lot of testosterone would help me gain more muscle, but once I'm back to a normal T level, I'll still be able to gain and keep more muscle than if I had never taken extra T at all. When a trans woman cuts her T levels, the muscle built up over the years doesn't simply go away. There are permanent physiological changes that allow her to reach levels of fitness that she would never have been able to achieve if she had been born a cis woman.
So when you go down to your testosterone total, it's 21. So
what's the normal range?
The normal optimal level is 700 at least 700.
Activists also argue that while men have greater bone mass than women, testosterone plays an important role in allowing them to gain that bone mass, and that if you nuke a man's testosterone level, his bone mass will likely come down as well. This argument is correct, but there's an important caveat here. When trans women transition, they don't just suppress their T levels. They also take supplemental estrogen, and do you know what estrogen does? It maintains bone mass. It seems highly unlikely that a trans woman would lose significant amounts of bone mass when they're taking large amounts of a hormone that's crucial in maintaining it. Interestingly, the most important thing to know about testosterone's relationship to athleticism is that it has no relationship to athleticism. When you compare men with men or women with women, you find virtually no correlation between testosterone and athletic accomplishments, and even trans activists admit this. This means the man with naturally high testosterone levels is not necessarily a better athlete than a man with naturally low testosterone levels.
They found in this elite set of male athletes, some men below the women's average for testosterone were competing at no competitive disadvantage with men that had 40 times as much testosterone.
However, when you compare men with women, you find massive differences. This is because testosterone levels mainly matter when they lead to androgenization. Androgenization is when someone acquires many of the secondary sex characteristics that we associate with masculinity. Cis women typically have T levels that don't androgenize them, and cis men typically have T levels that do. Even a man at the bottom of the reference range still has testosterone levels several times that of a woman at the top of the reference range. You're probably familiar with androgenization as male puberty, but there are other forms of it as well. For example, when female bodybuilders abuse steroids, they can often undergo virilization, which is just androgenization in cis women because of a hormone imbalance. They get a deep voice, facial hair, and a lot of other masculine traits that they often don't want. What's important to know about androgenization / virilization is that it's a one-way trip. When a woman starts getting a deep voice and facial hair, there is no way to hormonally undo that. Stopping the steroid use will halt the progress, but it won't reverse it. Think of testosterone like super soldier serum. It's been 80 years since Captain America became a super soldier, and whatever serum was left in his bloodstream was probably metabolized out years ago. Does that mean he can compete in combat sports? Of course not, because he's undergone the super soldier equivalent of androgenization, and those changes don't go away when he stops taking serum. The athletic differences we see between men and women are largely the result of irreversible androgenization during puberty. To understand how significant these changes are, let's take a look at just a few of the differences between men and women. On average, men have thicker bones, a higher center of mass, larger rib cages, larger hearts that pump more blood, higher hemoglobin levels, higher VO2 max, stronger tendons and ligaments, a larger and thicker skull, especially at the mandible, zygomatic arch, and brow. A lower Q angle, literally thicker skin, better motor unit recruitment, and faster and more consistent reaction times. This is not anywhere near an exhaustive list. It's merely an example of some of the differences that are present when adjusted for size, less likely to be affected by T levels, and are likely to create a significant advantage in combat sports. And I didn't even begin to cover the differences in muscle mass and strength, which are both significant and weirdly specific to fighting. And these differences lead to the next common argument, which is the idea that physical differences between trans women and cis women shouldn't matter because everyone is physically different. Now, it is true that some people are going to have athletic advantages that others don't possess. There are cis women who might have reaction times, VO2 max, or ligament strength higher than normal or even within a male range. However, the odds of a cis woman having all of the listed stats within a male range is virtually zero. The odds of a trans woman having those stats in a male range is pretty high. A trans woman having a massive number of traits in a male range is not at all comparable to a cis woman who might have one or two traits in a male range. Think about it. People can bench press 1,000 pounds, run 4-minute miles, run 2-hour marathons, and do double backflips. But if someone can do all of those things, they're blatantly superhuman and should not be allowed in MMA. There is a claim from trans athletes that getting their testosterone within a certain threshold makes their athletic performance virtually indistinguishable from cis women. This is a claim that might be true, but it needs a lot more evidence to support it. Showing that a trans athlete is within the female range of accomplishments is not enough. If I fought at women's strawweight right now, I might lose at a high level. But that does not mean it's fair for me to compete. If me and Rose Namajunas had similar skills, I would destroy her. She could only beat me because she has way more skill than me. If me and Rose Namajunas had our current levels of skill but the same physical body, she would destroy me. It just means that I'm not a very good fighter. Instead, trans athletes need to show convincing evidence that a gender transition takes someone from their spot in the male range to the same or similar spot in the female range. And they need to show this change for all of the physical differences I mentioned, and probably more. I will be the first to admit that this is a nearly impossible burden of proof because we simply don't have the data on it. However, anything less than that standard is simply insufficient. Because letting someone compete with significant and statistically impossible physical advantages is unconscionable. Now you might be thinking, what about people that transitioned before puberty and never went through androgenization? And I would guess that that is more likely to create an even playing field. But it still needs to be demonstrated that those trans women are within reasonable spots in the female range in all relevant aspects. While a lot of physical changes happen during puberty, it's not the source of every sex difference. We still need sufficient data and evidence before even those women can compete. Another commonly espoused argument is that competition is a human right and barring trans women from competition is discrimination.
So if you want to say, well, I believe you're a woman for all of society except this massive central part that is sport, then that's not fair.
I think this is a straw man argument because nobody's trying to bar them from competition as a whole. If I wanted to fight in MMA at 125 pounds, I wouldn't be allowed to do it because I'm nowhere near 125 pounds. But that doesn't mean I'm barred from competition because I am allowed to compete at higher weight classes. That doesn't mean I've been denied the right to compete, it just means I have to compete in a different division. Trans women are also allowed to compete, or at least should be allowed to compete. It might not be the division they want, but I'm not allowed to fight flyweights because we have rules to make things fair. It's easy to argue that trans women wouldn't stand a chance in the male category, and you're probably right. But winning competitions is not a human right. I'm 5'9 with a terrible vertical and no hand-eye coordination. But if I want to play basketball, I have to compete with adults. I don't get to compete with middle schoolers just because I'm untalented. And making me play against adults who could easily beat me doesn't mean you've violated my rights. If I try out for the NBA, that is a genuinely fair contest, even if I'm going to badly lose.
Scalabrini is a 43-year-old who's been retired for nearly a decade. Brian Scalabrini beat the high schooler 11-0.
Even if my level of talent and physical ability is below the normal adult range, I still don't get to play against children. I'm not saying cis women fight like children. I'm saying I'm so untalented at basketball that using children is the closest comparison I have. Now, I think the MMA community is largely on the same side when it comes to transgender athletes. However, there is one important counterpoint to this whole narrative that I think is an obvious source of hypocrisy. I've explained why previous exposure to testosterone can create permanent effects and why this should likely bar trans women from fighting against women. So why doesn't this apply to PED use? We constantly see fighters get popped for PED use, serve out a suspension, and then come back to competition. The MMA community seems to be admitting that your biology will eventually return to a baseline and the PEDs don't have permanent effects. Unfortunately, the evidence says this is wrong. There are obviously plenty of cases that aren't black and white, such as tainted supplements, picograms, use exemptions, failing to apply for a use exemption that you could have gained, etc. However, there are also a few obvious examples that we can all agree are blatant cheating. For example, TJ Dillashaw famously took EPO and became UFC champion before getting caught.
Let's start off, first and foremost, I cheated, right?
EPO allowed Dillashaw to work harder and recover faster. This could have allowed him to acquire levels of muscle mass and bone density that wouldn't be possible for an unenhanced athlete. And it is reasonable to assume that Dillashaw's athleticism might always be higher than a version of him that had never taken EPO. He now only has to maintain his increased abilities with the help of increased myonuclei. If we're going to ban trans women because of the permanent effects of past steroid exposure, then the same arguments can be used to decide that people like TJ Dillashaw should never, ever fight again. You could certainly argue that the lasting effects of EPO are going to be much less significant than the lasting effects of androgenization, and you're probably right. But there are still lasting effects. As long as we tolerate this kind of blatant cheating, I think we are being hypocritical and applying rules unfairly, and this is something that probably needs to be corrected. If trans women shouldn't fight cis women, TJ Dillashaw shouldn't fight anyone. So, what's the solution to all of this? Are we going to make trans women fight men? It's been suggested before that trans women should have their own division, which is a terrible idea. There have been 2 trans women fighters in the history of American MMA, and they didn't even compete at the same time. There's not enough trans fighters to create a trans fight, much less a trans division. Instead, I propose we stop classifying it as a women's division and a men's division, and instead classify it as a women's division and an open division. Only very specific people can compete in the women's division, but absolutely anyone can compete in the open division, including cis women. Each sport can have 1 restricted division and 1 open division. Usually the women's division will be the restricted division, but there are some sports where cis women might have an advantage over cis men, and so the men's division would be restricted. This way, we aren't misgendering trans athletes, but we're also maintaining a level of fairness. It might be fair to say that trans women would not fare well against cis men, and that's a valid point. But they're allowed to compete, they're not being misgendered, and I can't think of a better solution. Women's divisions were created so that women could showcase their exceptional talents without being effectively excluded by the biological realities of sex differences. There are a myriad of biological reasons that trans women should not compete with cis women, especially in sports like MMA. And allowing those matchups to happen would require trans athletes to provide a lot of evidence that our current understanding of androgens and sports science is wrong. However, I still think there are ways to make the current rules less hypocritical and give trans women a more obvious division in which to compete. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. And I know that this is a hot button issue, so be polite about it.